Nithyanandam paramasukadam kevalam jnanamurtim dvandvatitam gaganasadrisham tatvamasyadilakshyam ekam nityam vimalamachalam sarvadhi sakshibhutam bhavatitam trigunarahitam sadguram tam namami.
Nithyanandam, we welcome all the Shri Mahans, Mahans, Kotaris, Tanedars, Balasanths, visitors and viewers for this Vakyartha Sadhas conducted by Balasanths of Nithyananda Gurukul. Today's topic is what Swamiji spoke in today's satsang.
What is listening?
What I feel authentic listening is when we take in the information from the society around us and when we do not add any incompletions. See, usually when we hear something or we just see something, we start adding our own incompletions to it. We start perceiving it in a way. Maybe somebody might have just taken a notebook away from us for copying something from our book. But we'll start cognizing it like, oh, he's taking my book away. Maybe he does not want me to study properly. What is he trying? We'll start, you know, putting our own incompletions on it. So what I feel is authentic listening is when we do not put any incompletions and we just cognize the world as it is.
I have a question. What's the difference between hearing and listening?
Hearing is sound creates a new sounds creates only make an incompletion. Listening is when listening enters you, it creates completion in you.
What I feel is the difference between hearing and listening is in the case of hearing, we just don't care about it. We just hear something and we just don't care about it. It's almost like, you know, we just hear it because we're there. When somebody just tells us something and we don't care much about it, we just hear to them, we won't listen to them. But when we are in completion and we just absorb the whole thing, whatever words or whatever comes to us, when we absorb the whole thing and create completion in us, is what I feel is listening.
I have a question what Yoga Mitra said a few seconds ago. Like he said that listening is when we just perceive the thing as it is. We see it as it is, we don't add our own incompletions and perceptions into it. But then like whatever we cognize is from our perception and from our thought patterns only, right? So how does listening happen?
What I feel is, like whenever we are going to listen, we must not think, like something happens to us now, any situation may happen to us, we must not add any of our incompletions. We must just see the situation as it is. Even if we might think, you know, for example, the same case of somebody taking a book, we must never think that, oh, he's starting to put me down in studies, he's taking my book, maybe he might tear some pages off. You must not think anything like this. We must just see the situation as it is. We must see, oh, this person has taken my book. Let me go find out why he is taking my book. What I feel is this will be a better way of cognizing than adding incompletions to our situations.
I have a doubt. What is actually seeing the situations as it is?
What I feel is looking at situation as it is when you just like feel like without adding of your incompletions or any of what you feel, just looking at it from the way it is and not adding any incompletions to it.
How do you know whether you're seeing the situation as it is or not?
What I feel is, when the sound enters you, whatever like you're listening to enters you and causes a few emotions or any incompletions in you, that time you're not seeing the situation as it is. But when it enters you, and you know, you bring more and more completion or you bring more and more seeking, that point what I feel is, you're just upseeing the situation as it is. Because if we see something with our own incompletions, whatever comes inside, we'll mix everything together and it'll cause more fear or any emotion in us. But when we get into the space of seeing things as it is, we will just see it as it is. We'll not add any incompletions. We will just, you know, like, understand the situation and we'll try to find out why.
Then does that mean you're seeing the reality because you're just seeing it as it is?
What I feel is, we seeing the reality as it is of a completely different level. But this, we seeing the small situations around us without we adding any incompletions to it or without, you know, like us doing anything, just seeing it as it is, not seeing the reality. Because we seeing the reality is a totally different level.
I have a question with what Mitra told. See, when even when you're seeing the reality, you will be seeing it as it is because you'll not put any incompletion at that time. Now, what do you actually mean by that it's actually a total different level itself?
What I feel is when you see the normal situations, we just see it as it is. But when you see the reality, when you start perceiving the reality like Swamiji or the enlightened beings, we will just know. The context of us seeing everything will completely be different. The whole thing will just be for completion and seeking. So what I feel is the realities, when we see the reality, it's a completely different context, and we see the normal situation in a totally different context.
I have a question. Few statements ago, we came to a conclusion that when we're in listening, it doesn't bring any emotion in us, and it'll just lead us more and more to the space of completion, right? If you see, like, a small kid, it'll not have any patterns or any incompletions. Because of that, it's in pure listening. So when it is in that space of listening, that's where whatever it sees around, it's taking inside it and getting different emotions. That's how, right, we learn like the idea of anger and different things from the society. So that means even when you're listening, whatever you're listening to is what is mattering, right? So if you're listening to someone who's angry, we'll also get that anger, which is an emotion.
What I feel is when we are as a baby, we didn't have the intelligence, we are still ignorant. So we didn't know what to take in, what to like exclude. So we listen to everything around us, even bad stuff. But now with this, what Swami is telling us, how to be listening only for right things. So when you start listening to only right things, only right memories will go inside you.
I have a question on what Tattva Maharaj said. How do you know what is right to listen to?
What I feel is when you start listening itself, you will know what's right or wrong. Because if somebody is saying you do this, do that, like you have to understand the context in which they are saying that also. That's why you have to give full listening to know what's happening around you. Like if they are saying go steal something from this person or that person or go hit somebody, you will know when you're giving full listening, you will know that that's not right for you to do, or you'll not expand anybody next to you. You'll have that intelligence for you yourself, and you'll have the right cognition also. Because when you're fully listening, you'll know what's happening around you, and you'll know you'll have the particular cognition where you know what's right and what's wrong.
What I feel is like any situation in your life, whatever it might be, you should give your listening to that. But only after you give the listening, only after receiving the information from outside and internalizing it, you should decide whether you should do that, whatever it is, or you should not do it. Like if it's something bad, then only after you listening to that, only after you being open to receive what that is, then you can choose whether you should be performing this action or not, whether you should be listening to this or not.
I have a doubt with what Ajahn Maharaj said. He was just telling that when you're listening completely, then you'll know what's wrong and what's right, and you'll know what to do before doing anything. You should have the listening, right? But then one of the satsang Swamiji said that just make it happen. In that happening satsang, he told, just do it whether you know it's right or wrong. Just do it so that Kalabhairava will be able to teach you. So what do you mean listen to anything before even deciding to do something?
See, but what I feel is like from that immature cognition, then you have to start raising to the higher cognition. You just can't keep doing something wrong and just waiting for Kalabhairava to teach you something. So when you know something is wrong, instead of just listening to that and making the same mistake again, you can cognize with the higher cognition, and with the liberated thinking, you can know that whether, like, if you take the example of incompletion, you can't just keep on be getting into incompletion, listening to incompletion, and then waiting for Kalabhairava to teach you a lesson. So before itself, you should decide that when the incompletion comes, I'll not decide for it. I'll give my listening to it and I'll complete it immediately. So when you start thinking from this context, there'll be no need for you to get into the incompletion.
Adding a point, what I also understood when Swamiji said that was like from a different context. He said it from the context of not postponing things in your life and saying, I'll do it later, it might not work out, I'll do it later. But in this context, it's like whether it's right or wrong, whether it directly leads us to enlightenment or not. So if we feel it's right, and if we feel it aligns us to the context of our life, then we should do it. But if we don't feel it's right, then we should listen to ourselves and then restore. So what I feel is the context is different.
Adding a point, in the same satsang, like when he was speaking about it happening and postponing, he also told, like, first priority is do what you think is right. And second priority is only, like, if you don't know whether something is right or wrong, at least do that action so that life can teach you. Otherwise, if you are constantly in the space of postponing things, you'll never learn from life. So what I feel is that what I understood when Swamiji told that is, obviously so many points you'll know which is the right thing. So our first option should be like deciding for life. Whereas the second priority, if you don't know whether the action you're going to do is going to be right or wrong, when you just do it, you'll learn from that.
I have a question. Is context is higher than listening?
I have a question in what you told. How can you even get a context before listening? Like, only when you even listen, you'll get a context, right?
What I feel is context is higher than listening, because only if you set a context, you can be in listening. Because even though you're not in listening, the context will bring you back to the space of listening and make you listen. Like, for example, if we don't have the context of Vakyas, you'll not even listen. But if we make you understand the context, you will start listening. So what I feel is context is higher than listening.
But then I have a question, because Swamiji said bliss and being in the space of listening is just our nature. So how can we have a context for that? And also newborn babies and all, what context will they have? They're always in the space of listening. So what context will they have to listen?
What I feel is both are equal. When you listen, we get the context. When you have a context, we listen.
I don't feel context is equal to listening, because only if you set the context, you'll even start listening. Otherwise, you'll not even know why you have to listen to the person. So what if you only have the context, only have the context of listening, then only you'll start listening. Otherwise, you'll not even start listening.
But what I feel is that, only when you have listening, you'll even get the context. Because if you see, our normal nature itself is when we are born and all, we are automatically in the space of listening. So whatever, when life is presenting us the right context, at that time only if we listen, we'll even catch the context. What I feel is the context is important for us to be continue to be in the space of listening. Because if at that point, if you miss the context, you'll not continue to listen. Anything can easily, any incompletion, you'll not get back to the space of listening. So what I feel is that listening is our very nature, and for us to continue to be in that space of listening, we need to have the right context. What I feel is that both are equal and both are important.
I have a question of today's morning satsang. In today's satsang, Swamiji told about worshipping the perishable. Can somebody explain me, how can you worship the perishable?
What I understood when Swamiji told that is, if you see so many times, the cognition about ourselves will be based on the perishables. We may think that we are this body and all. So what I feel is that only when our context, the cognition about us transforms into the space of imperishable, only then we'll have a mature cognition about ourselves, and whatever we want will just be caused. And what if is that to get that, we need that authentic listening in us. Because when we're as a kid, we'll be having that listening in us. But at that point, we'll not be, whatever the society around us has, whatever we see anger, we just take it in. All the incompletions, we just take it in. So what I feel is that only when you have that authentic listening, with that intelligence, with whatever Swamiji is telling, with that intelligence, when you are in the space of listening, then automatically your cognition about yourself starts maturing, and from the space of perishable, you'll move to the space of imperishable.
I have a question about listening. In one of the book, in Guaranteed Solution book, Swami told that if you're going to achieve something, whether you're going to become a lawyer or engineer or scientist or anything, you have to listen to that, then you'll be able to achieve it. How is it that when you're listening to that, you're going to achieve something?
I didn't get your question properly. What is when you're listening to that?
What I feel is that, when you're in the space of listening, then automatically, what I first of all understand as listening is not just this, hearing and cognizing the right thing. What I feel is that you just being in the present moment is what I understand as listening. So when you are in the present moment, automatically you'll not put your past ideas and incompletions in whatever is happening in life. So you'll be able to reinvent yourself with whatever is happening around you. So when you're continuously reinventing yourself, then automatically the cognition what you have about yourself will mature more, and because of which you'll start expressing various dimensions of you. So when you start expressing in different dimensions, then automatically you will know the best field which you need to choose and you will be able to perform well in that. So this is what I understood when she told listening to that, like whatever you want to become, just listening to that.
I have a question. What's the difference between awareness and listening?
What I feel is, when we start to listen to everything around us, naturally the space of awareness also will just follow. For example, if we start listening to everything around us, we will start becoming completely aware of our surroundings. We will start noticing each and every minute detail around us, what is actually happening, and we start becoming very aware. So what I feel is, when we get into the space of listening, the space of awareness will just follow.
But like, for example, now you're talking and when I'm listening to you, how will I be aware of something else which is happening on the other side? So like, because like, if I'm listening, how can I can be aware of what you're talking alone, right? How if this flower is moving, then how will I be aware that this flower is moving?
What I feel like Swamiji, even though when he's talking, like if somebody just uses their cell phone to take a photo of him, he just catches him, because he doesn't just listen to them. When you just practice listening, your listening will become so powerful that you not just listen to them but the whole cosmos. You'll be listening to everything which happens in the cosmos.
Adding to his point, what I also feel is when you first start initially listening, you will first you'll be able to solve your problems, and you'll be you'll know how to solve each and everything. You'll face situations out of listening and completion and everything. But then when you start really listening, in one of the Upanishads they say that train your eyes also to listen, eyes and ears and everything to listen. So when you start doing that continuously, when you're completely into listening, as Swamiji told, one day when he was going out, he saw one van moving. At that point, he saw our flag. So what I feel is, even the small things we start seeing, we stop our vision just because of non-listening. That is why Swamiji once told us to go tell Kalabharava about that. So what I feel is, when you start listening and training eyes also to listen, you will notice all these minute things. As you gave the example of the flower, though you are listening to Vakyartha says here, what we are speaking to, but still, if anybody or that flower is moving or anything is moving, you will be able to see that, because in complete authentic listening to everything around you.
What I feel is, like, it'll just come by practice. When you just keep on practicing in your life, you can move into the higher levels. Like, even for completion, if you just get incomplete every day, you might just be listening to Swamiji's truths and just doing completion in the mirror every day night before sleeping. And by that, you get completion. And then later on, when you start practicing that, you get completion as a bigger priority in you. Then you start being complete, and whenever incompletions come, you know how to just, like, drop it whenever it comes. So then that perpetual completion will come. And then when you know that completion is the only priority, then you know that the incompletion itself should not enter you, and you should just continuously be in completion. So the same way, even in listening, when you just learn to listen to someone, and you will just start getting into the higher levels of listening. Like how Swamiji tells, like, not only wherever I am sitting, I am able to listen to everyone, even wherever my photo is, I am able to listen through that. So when Swamiji just practices listening, the same way when we also practice listening, we will just be able to move into the higher levels and listen even more.
I have a question, like, even if you're listening, only when you have that intelligence you'll even transform, right? Like, otherwise, even a kid is also in listening, and Swamiji is also in listening. But because Swamiji is having that intelligence, he's able to, like, listen to the right things and expand it. So you need to have intelligence, right?
What I feel is, the intelligence will automatically come when you practice. Because when you start practicing, you won't be able to go further if you don't have the intelligence to know what is listening and what is completion. Only when you get that intelligence that what listening and completion can do to you and the people around you, the space of completion which can be brought into you and others, then only with that space you can be continuing to practice and move into higher levels. So what I feel is, like, automatically the intelligence will come.
Adding a point, what I also feel is that the intelligence will just come with the listening. Like, suppose you're when in the space of complete listening, then life will teach us through so many ways how to transform and become enlightened. So just by the way life teaches us, and just by giving our listening to life completely, we'll just get that intelligence and transform.
So just adding a point, in guaranteed solution itself, Swami told that hearing plus right cognition is listening. So when you're listening, automatically the right cognition also happen to you, because when you're listening, you'll know what's right and what's wrong. You'll not like fall back and you'll not have the intelligence at all. You will have the intelligence and to decide what's right for you and what's right for others also.
Like for example, if you listen, you tell like a few statements ago, we came to a conclusion that there'll be no emotions at all inside you. But if you're in complete listening and someone is coming and telling you something like something nice that has happened, then automatically you'll feel happy only, right? So happiness is also an emotion only. So does that mean that you were not in listening?
What I feel is like when you are in listening, at that moment, whatever happens to you, either it can be only completion. Because like you just put different names, like different emotions, you just give different names, and like because when you are incomplete, each incompletion you have, you just put it at some emotion. So when someone comes and tells you something nice, you feel happy. And when someone comes and tells you you won some game or something like that, you just feel excited. So you just have different incompletions to put for different emotions. Because someone tells you that you win some game or something, you just get that praise, so that excitement just comes. So what I feel is like when you are in the pure space of listening, the only thing which can happen to you is only completion, not happiness or any emotion like that.
So, like, if you don't have any emotions when you are in the space of listening, does that mean that you will not have any thoughts when you are in the space of listening?
What I feel is when you are listening, you will not have any thoughts, but you'll have that right cognition where you will think so much. Because there is a difference between thoughts and thinking. Thinking happens with your conscious effort there. Because when you are thinking, you'll like when you are doing something, like if you are doing your homework, you will only be thinking about your homework. But thought is something where, like I am sitting here now, I am speaking something, then I go somewhere else. It just takes you somewhere. But when you are listening, you will not have that, like just dragging that, like daydreaming and all that, but you'll have the right cognition and the right thinking also. You'll have that right decision, right thinking, which happens at that time. You'll not have thoughts at that time.
I have a question. What's the exact difference between thoughts and thinking?
What I think is that when you're thinking is something which happens with your effort. Like when you are being in this awareness, you're thinking that you're going to do this. After this, you're going to do this. Like you'll have a particular way of thinking the whole stuff. Like if you're deciding for something, like you're going to do homework, okay, you're going to do math worksheet or something, and you're sitting and like thinking only about that. Okay, after this division, you're going to do this multiplication, all that. So it's basically the whole thing is like the way you are deciding to think about it. Like you have that conscious effort to do the whole thing. But thoughts is something like you're sitting here for Vakyartha Sadhas and you're hearing all of us speaking. Then you heard somebody speaking outside ashram. Then after that, outside ashram, you went to this place, and it just takes you away from the present moment. So that is what is thoughts. It just takes you out of this present moment. Just you'll not have any connection between one thought and another. That's what is thought.
What I feel is, like, we get many thoughts in a day. So based on our thoughts only, we start to think about something. For the same example of the math homework, if we just get a thought, oh, I have to do a math homework, I have not yet completed it. Immediately we start thinking, okay, now I'll go finish my math homework and do this. Immediately after math homework, go play or take some rest. Immediately you'll plan your day. So what I feel is, based on your thoughts, you start thinking, and based after you think, you'll start executing it.
Like, what do you mean by thoughts are disconnected? Because only with a particular connection you can go to the next thought, right?
What I feel is, like, how are thoughts disconnected in a sense? Many times in a day we'll be just thinking about something. Suddenly we realize and we just think about something else. Maybe we might be, when you're outside, you might just be thinking, okay, we might be planning for a summer holidays. You might just think what you want to do in the summer. Suddenly you will just realize that, oh, my mother called me, I have to go immediately. You'll just run off to do some work your mother gave you. You may be thinking something completely different, but you'll just shift to the something else. You might just remember something suddenly and shift. So what I feel is, like, many a time we just shift our thoughts. we might be thinking about something completely different, and we might start doing something or think about something else immediately. So what I feel is our thoughts can be disconnected many times.
Okay, just giving an example. Just think that you're eating and you're seeing one of your friends walking, and you like, oh, I saw them yesterday. Then in that thing that, okay, I went to their house yesterday, then you saw their dog at their house, and the same dog you saw somewhere else looks the same way, and that dog was in this color, and it came to my house. See, your house and his house and his dog will not even be related to each other, but this is how the thoughts even go. Like, you started from seeing your friend, but it went to your house by the dog which you saw in his house and all that. This is how the whole thought will not be even connected. It maybe started from one thought to another, but it will not have any reasonable connection with each other.
What I feel is thoughts are not at all connected, because it will just continuously, randomly, you just get few thoughts, and like how she gave the example, just meeting a friend and you go, just deviate yourself with different things. But thinking and listening is from right cognition, especially listening, when you are completely listening to the other person, you will have the right cognition on it, and you will be completely into the other, like what the other person, and waiting for listening just to the other person.
If you want to be listened like Swamiji, please come for Nithyananda, which is going to happen December.
With this, we come to the conclusion of today's Vakyartha Sadhas, and we'll continue to explore the deeper truths in the further Vakyartha Sadhas. Now, we'll conclude the Purna Mantra.
Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamataya Purnameva Vasishyate. Om Shanti 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 Hi Harihi Om Tat Sat Sarvam Sadguru Padukar Pranamastu Om Nityanandam.